Father Pedro, Father Regina, and Your Eminence, distinguished guests, dear friends, brothers and sisters. 3 years ago, the historic humanistic initiative of His Holiness Pope Francis, Laudato Si, praise be to you, God, titled On Care for Our Common Home, was made public. In Laudato Si, His Holiness calls for an international dialogue about how to approach and act upon the ecological crisis and embraces human diversity to unify efforts to protect Earth, the gift of our Lord. Here today, we have come together in this esteemed conference to bring more public awareness to this global audacious vision, and it is a special honor for me to be invited to participate and to be asked to speak on this solemn occasion on behalf of the Wasatiyya Islamic Moderate Movement. It is a blessing to be here with you addressing these challenges. Laudato Si is a passionate appeal addressed to every person living on this planet, calling for a new dialogue and action about the preservation of our common home. In his personal, powerful message, Pope Francis hopes to open our eyes, our minds, and our hearts to the extent of harm and damage we are inflicting on our natural habitat, and the big challenge it presents to face up to it, and to do something to change such habits, emphasizing that any deterioration of the environment harms us all. The questions this raises, to what extent are we aware of the destruction we are causing the environment we live in and cannot live without? How can we make people more aware of the need to leave a better environmental legacy to be shared by our children? How can we develop new beliefs, convictions, attitudes, and way of life that would help us achieve this? The environment, Pope Francis contends, is God's handiwork and gift to humanity, and thus we have to take upon ourselves the solemn oath to be its protectors and guardians, and not to use our technological skills and capabilities which God has endowed upon us to tarnish the beauty of this handicraft, but to seek to make it our earth rich, beautiful, and prosperous. In Laudato Si, Pope Francis asserts, we are not God. The earth was here before us, and it has been given to us. And given dominion over the earth does not mean our domination over its destiny, nor would it give us the right to transform it to satisfy our materialistic instincts. Here, Pope Francis urges us to stop and reflect on the environment damage we are having behind and leaving behind for our next generation. He astutely observes a great cultural, spiritual, and educational challenge standing before us. And he warns that it will demand that we set out on the long path of renewal. He observes that in education, we may redeem ourselves. Education and environmental responsibility can encourage ways of acting which directly and significantly affect the world around us. To achieve such goals, he urges the public and civic institutions to pressure political authorities to intervene so that the urgent needs are met. In his humanistic outlook, Pope Francis links the human environment and the natural environment, and correctly perceives that the deterioration in one leads to the deterioration in the other, and reversely, the improvement in one leads to the betterment of the other. Laudato Si is a call directed not only to Christians, but to non-Christians as well, imploring all human beings to take seriously and actively these concerns for the welfare of our Mother Earth. The message is not only in line with the Church's social doctrine, but also in line with the other Abrahamic faiths, namely the Quran's Islamic teachings, which I will explore, as well as the Jewish religious teaching, which my colleague, Rabbi David Rosen, will talk about. The Holy Quran, which is considered by all Muslims to be the core source for Islamic doctrine and beliefs, asserts how God created man of earth, and that the same earth is God's creation, bestowed by the grace of its creator to humanity that they may appreciate. It is a right and a responsibility to utilize and harness nature which God has bestowed upon us, which obligates us to protect and to conserve it. The Quran asserts that God has created a wonderful, exquisite environment for humans and has provided all natural resources they need, that we may seek contemplation, enjoyment, and the appreciation of our Lord's artistic design. It follows that man has an obligation not to cause any degradation to the environment and the distortion of its suitability for human habitat. The Quran stresses the value of life and how life must be preserved and protected. It calls upon the believers to protect animal and plant life, not to pollute water resources, and not to contaminate the atmosphere in order to improve the quality of life. In the universe, there is enormous diversity and variety of form and function. The universe and its various elements fulfill human welfare and are evidence of the Creator's greatness. There is not a thing he has created but celebrates and declares his praise. This theme resonates in many Quranic verses. And allow me to use some of these verses, because I'm sure that not many of us are familiar with the Quran or didn't have the opportunity to read the Quran. And thus, allow me to use some of these verses to just let you have a feeling of what the Quran asserts. In chapter 14, verse 32, the Quran states, "And he has made the ships to be of service unto you, that they may sail the sea by his command, and the rivers he has made of service unto you. And he has made the sun and the moon constant in their courses to be of service unto you. And he has made of service unto you the night and day. And he gives you all you seek of him. If you would count the bounty of God, you would never reckon it." In another chapter, verse 61, it says, "It is he who has produced you from earth and settled you herein." In chapter 24, 41, it says, "Have you not seen that God is glorified by all in the heavens and on the earth, such as the birds with wings outspread? Each knows its worship and glorification, and God is aware of what they do. And he has set within it mountains standing firm and blessed it, and ordained in its diverse sustenance in 4 days alike for all that seek." In another chapter it says, "And the sign for them is the lifeless earth. We bring it to life and bring forth from it grain of which they eat. and we have made therein gardens of palms and vines. Another verse it says, He who has spread out the earth for you and threaded roads for you therein and has sent down water from the sky. With it have we brought forth diverse kinds of vegetation. Eat and pasture your cattle. Verily, in this are signs for men endued with understanding. Water is a very significant element in Islam, and it calls for its preservation. Not only that, because the Arabs were living in the desert, and water was one of the main elements for life, but also that God says that we have created you of water. There is a lot in water, there is life. And that's why it is so important for us to protect these elements. The Quranic scripture tells us that everything God has created, He created by measure and in balance. Verily, all things we have created by measure, He says. Everything to Him is measured, and we have produced therein everything in balance. So balance is so important, it's the most important concept in the Quran, I believe. Everything God has created is full of meaning also, pointing beyond itself to the glory of God. We have not created the heavens and the earth and all that is between them carelessly. It was created very carefully. This necessitates that the relationship between man and the universe be a reciprocal relation of care and nurture for Mother Earth, which provides man with his food and water, particularly since Earth has not been created exclusively for the benefit of humans, but that God has bestowed his bounty to benefit all of his creation. The resources upon which life depends have been created by God as a trust in man's care to provide sustenance for all people and for all living creatures. The Quran asserts that the basic elements of nature, water, air, fire, and earth, belong to all living things. In a number of verses, the Quran instructs the believers not to do acts which may cause the degradation of the environment and entrust man with the protection of natural resources. It is interesting to note that those elements of nature knows no boundaries or limitations created by man. A polluted river runs from one country to another. A disease caused by careless rubbish would travel from one neighborhood to another and from one country to another. Human beings should not be wasteful, nor should they abuse, misuse, or distort the natural resources, as each generation is entitled to benefit from them. The Quran urges man to balance his use of natural resources in accordance to his human needs, stating that he created us to be a moderate, just community that are temperate. The Quran says, and thus we have made you a just, middle ground, balanced community. And this is actually the slogan we use in our Wasatiyya moderate movement. The Wasatiyya moderate movement was created back in 2006 and 2007 because of an incident that took place in 2006 that I would like to take a few minutes to explain to you so that you can understand the way things we believe in. I was standing on the balcony of my apartment overlooking an Israeli checkpoint. And I was observing, it was on a Friday morning, it was Ramadan, and Muslims worshippers wanted to go to Jerusalem to pray. But they didn't have permits. And so the checkpoint was pushing them back. And these people, hundreds of them, were pushing forward. in order to go through the checkpoint to Jerusalem. However, I was Azar and the soldiers were throwing at them tear gas, and I was observing from my office what will be happening. I was thinking that the clash will result in shooting and in killing, and then because neither will be willing to actually speak to the other or reach a compromise with the other. But I was wrong, because a few minutes later I noticed that things, the tension cooled down, and it seemed that there was an agreement made by the officer at the checkpoint and the people on the checkpoint, pushing against the checkpoint, in which the soldiers brought buses and allowed the people to cross after searching them and taking their ID. And then the buses took them to Jerusalem to pray. The buses brought them back, and then they got their IDs and went home. So I was observing what has happened and thinking that this is, in terms of game theory, a win-win situation. The soldiers worried about security, and the people worried about missing the prayer at the Haram Sharif. And so both of them agreed to something which makes sense, that if I'm worried about security, allow them to cross but check them out. At the same time, take them to the Haram and then bring them back, and then it is a win-win situation. Both of them has achieved what they wanted. So I was observing this and thinking, in Palestine, there are 12 Palestinian political Islamic parties, but none of them would have accepted to make that compromise or to deal, to have that initiative. And so I decided that I asked myself, who represents these people? Who represents moderates in Islam? We hear a lot about extremists, but who are the moderates? Who represents these moderates? And so that's how I started this movement, so that to promote a culture of moderation, balance within the community, so that we can stand up against extremism and against hijacking of our religion. And thus, going back to the Quran, we have taken the concept that are in the Quran, which calls for moderation. And this verse, which says, and thus we have made you a just community, it is verse 143 of the second chapter in the Quran, which is called Al-Baqarah Surah. And in this verse, it comes exactly in the midst of that chapter, because this is verse 143, and the chapter is 286 verses. So it comes exactly in the middle. And that's why I felt that this symbolism there signifies what God would have us to think in terms of balance, in terms of justice, in terms of being able to be temperate, being able to look at the other and see the human person in the other. And that's why I started this movement we call Wasatiyah, which is in Arabic means middle ground or center or middle. And then went back to the Quranic scripture and used the Quranic scripture to support our position and our vision of a moderate nation, of being balanced. And so that's why in the Quran it calls, don't squander wastefully, for the wasteful are Satan's brothers. Eat and drink, but avoid excesses. He likes not those who waste by extravagance. The Quran calls upon man to work to make the earth flourish through agriculture, gardening, and production. It appoints each man and woman to be the custodian of nature. It is our ethics that work is part of prayer. And being able to work and being able to achieve, and for human, to be able to be good. So basically, Our concept is that Islam did not come to negate the others. It did not come to replace the others. It did not come to demolish the ideas presented by the others, but rather Islam came to continue the messages that God has sent with different prophets in order to let them know of his existence, of his greatness, of his creation. And so that's why our concept of moderation is a concept which struggles against extremism. It is a concept that looks at the Quran and interprets it from a human side, that it is the humanity that matters. It's not the stone, it is not the air, it's not the money, it is not the struggle that we have on material things, but rather it is the struggle to work together. And that's why in the Quran it says, had God wished, he would have made us all one nation. Had God wished, he would have made us all believe in one religion. However, that's not what God wished. God wished us to be a diverse, pluralistic society in which that we are here to be tested, to be good, to be actually, and in God's judgment, those who are best are not those who belong to certain creeds or faith, but rather those who are pious. Those who are pious are those who work for the good. And so here the concept of doing good is much more than praying, is much more important in Islam than believing. Because you are tested in your belief by your work. And that's why it is so important. That's why when Pope Francis talks about sitting on the balcony, actually in Islam, Christianity, and Judaism, it is not important to sit there as much as to come down to the street and clean the street and do good to your fellow friend, fellow person next to you. And so this is where you don't have to worry if somebody is taking my place on the balcony. You don't have to worry, how will I go back all those stairs up to the balcony? But rather to think that if I go down, I do good, and that's where what will be the test of God. And that's why we call for interfaith dialogue, because we feel there is so much ignorance about each other, whether we are Muslims, Christians, or Jews, or none of the above. We don't know much about each other. I am a Muslim. I don't know much about Christianity, about Judaism, and about Buddhism. And so I have to educate myself on that. And here also it is so important that we be able, as a Jew, as a Christian, as a Muslim, as a believer, to learn about each other and to be able to reach out to each other. The Quran says, and do no mischief on the earth after it has been set in order. That will be best for you if you have faith. And do good as God has been good to you, and do not seek to cause corruption in the earth. God does not love the corruptors. Children of Adam, dress well whenever you are at worship, and eat and drink as we have permitted, but do not be extravagant. God does not like extravagant people. Guided by the Quran, Prophet Muhammad placed much significance to the sustainable use of natural resources and protection of wildlife and agricultural land, and forbade abuse of nature. He taught people to be moderate, live on less, protect animal and plant life, and to worship the Creator by being observant of his creations. The Prophet called upon the believers to be in harmony with nature. He prohibited cutting trees that provided shade and shelter to man and to animals. He prescribed picking up litter from the streets as an act of faith. He said, even if the day of judgment would arrive and you are building and you are holding a sampling in your hand, planted. He was quoted as saying, "The earth is green and beautiful, and God has appointed you his stewards over it." Another quote, "The world is beautiful and verdant, and verily God, be he exalted, he made you his stewards in it, and he sees how you acquit yourselves. Whoever plants a tree and diligently looks after it until it matures and bears fruit will be rewarded." Another quote, "If a Muslim plants a tree or sows seeds, and then a bird or a person or an animal eats from it, it is regarded as a charitable act for him." Thus, environmental conservation in Islam is a religious duty, a civil responsibility, and a social obligation, and all human beings are held accountable for that. But the question is, do man do that? And do man, and these are very nice words. They tell us what to do. But the question is, do we practice that? Unfortunately, we don't. I look at my community and see that there is a big gap between what is being preached and what is being practiced. For instance, it is a part of our culture. I advised one of the owners of a school that maybe you should do one day for the environment, and maybe it will be good for you to teach your children, the students, to be able to go out and plant a tree, or to go out and clean the yard, or to go out and paint the walls. Said Wasatiya will be very willing to provide you with anything that you might need to do it. And then he started by letting his students clean the yard after they made such a big mess. Every day they will make that mess when they go on recess. But this time he asked them before they go back to class that they should clean it. So they cleaned it. But next day, the parents came to him and said to him, "Wow, we did not send our kids for your school to be garbage collectors. They are not supposed to be that. You bring garbage collectors to do that, but not our students, not our children." So he came to me and said, you caused a revolt in the school because of that. And I said, "Well, why don't you stand up to these parents and tell them this is part of education?" And his answer was, "But they warned me that if I do it again, they will pick up the students from my school." And I said, "What if they would do that? Maybe that would be a lesson for them." He said, "No, but I will lose money because they pay tuition. And so if they pick up any one of their students, any of their sons, then I lose." So here, this materialistic mentality that we have is really affecting the way we teach our children. Also another experience that I have had with this culture of really not observing the welfare of the community is that when students used to go to bathroom at the university in order to wash before prayer, we are supposed to pray 5 times a day as a Muslim, and Islam teaches us that we have to be clean to be able to pray. So people go to these washrooms, to the bathrooms, and then they wash themselves, and they make such a mess out of it. So I told the teachers, "Why don't you teach your children, the students, that when they go in and they go out, they clean behind them?" And they said, "They will not listen to us." So I went to the janitor who was in charge, and I told them, "Why don't you clean that after the students leave?" And they said, "Well, if I clean it, when they come for the second prayer, they'll make it the same mess. So why should I clean it if it will become the same mess again?" And I said, "Why are we having you here?" why don't we replace you and then let them do what they want? Why are you here? So basically, I think that the same idea and the same culture, I had a problem with one of the people working for me, is that he was supposed to come and clean my office. And then I went into the office and found that the dust is still there. So I called him. I said, the dust is here and you are not cleaning it. And he said, well, when I clean it, but later it will come back, so why should I clean it? And so it is part of the culture that we have to address. And we have, when we are talking about the environment, we have, it is not only to educate them, it is really to put it in their mind, in their life, in their system, that they have to do it. You walk on campus and you will find that there is a garbage waste disposal, and then they bring their coffee, they drink it, and then they put it on the wall next to it. Why is it the culture will not let us take it and put it in the garbage? You walk also here at the Memela Mall, and you will tend to find that. Now, the same problem we have with this East Jerusalem, West Jerusalem. You go to West Jerusalem, and the municipality takes very good care of it. You go to East Jerusalem, and the municipality does not take that good care of it. And so you don't see the flowers, you don't. And so I come to the people there and tell them, why don't you clean in front of your stores? And they will tell me, but this is not our responsibility. This is the responsibility of the municipality. And we pay money or nona for that. And I say, but if the municipality does not do that, why don't you do that? Why don't you plant? You take the initiative to plant. So this dependency on the other, on the government, on the municipality to do it for us, we have to end this dependency, this idea of dependency. We have to end it. We have to put it in our culture, know that I am responsible. It is my responsibility to do that. And in this way, we can do it. And it's fascinating for me because I remember very well in the 50s and 60s, when I used to walk in the old city, it used to be very clean. And people used to clean in front of their stores, and then you will walk. And now I walk, and it is so dirty. It is so people. And then I, even that one of the shopkeepers was telling me that he, when it is 6 and he wants to leave, he waits till his neighbors leave because he is afraid that his neighbors will dump their garbage in front of his store and then go home. And so he waits till they are going so that they don't do that. But I said, but the culture in the 50s and 60s was that each, even if there is garbage in front of your store, they will clean it for you. Because that's the culture it was. But now, the more materialistic we become, the more unaware of what damage we are doing to our environment, to our culture, to the way we do things. And that's why I believe that it is so important for us to think in terms of the future, not the present. I was taught when I was in grade 1, there was a story, although it was back in 1952 that I was taught this story, but I still remember it very vividly. And the story tells about this king who walks into the fields and finds this old man planting an olive tree. And the king looks at him and wants to tease him. So he tells him, old man, you are planting this olive tree, do you expect to eat from it? And the old man responds, our grandparents planted and we ate. And we plant so that our grandchildren will eat. So the king liked the story, and so he gave him some money. And the king looked, and the old man looked at him and said, you see how fast this side of the story. He told him, you are also right. After they left, the wife looked at him and said, but Rabbi, how can they both be right? And he said to her, you are also right. So actually, I was trying to use that story in a workshop with imams, and I was telling them that in order that there are various shades of truth. Each one, it is like the nine blind people asked to describe an elephant, and each one described it from his point of view. So I was telling them this side of the story about this rabbi, and one of the imams was very upset and left the room. And I thought maybe because I used the story about the Jew, because I used the Jewish story, he's upset. So after the workshop, I went out and asked him, Sheikh, why are you upset? Why did you leave the room? He said, because you said it was a rabbi who did it, while actually it was a sheikh who did it. So in our concept, and the same stories, we borrow from each other these stories, and yet we brand them in our way. But in having dialogue with each other and talking to each other, we might reach the same thing. That's why, and when Pope Francis is talking about the environment, we tend to find that this environment, or talk about the environment in other religions and in other ways of thinking. And here, the Pope is talking about a garden in which there are flowers, there are trees, there are different trees, different fruits. Basically, what he says, walk into this garden and enjoy it, and keep it clean, and keep it enjoyable. Now, what we say, we look at the garden and say, there should be more cherry trees. No, should be less apple trees. There should be less this, more this. And so it's such a destructive criticism that instead of enjoying what he's saying and being inspired by it, what we are doing is that we are being close-minded, don't hear what he is saying, but rather and walking in and trying to see the negative side of it. What he is saying is simple. He's saying this earth we have inherited as man, this earth, and we have to keep it. If you want, keep it for your selfish reason, because you are living here, because you are the one benefiting from it. You are the one that will, if it is a good environment, you are the one which will live a healthy life, a better life, a happy life, a prosperous life. But if it is bad, how can you feel good about yourself even? And that's why when I was in Jena, Germany, I was walking in the parks, and then I found those bottles. People would drink wine or gin, and then they dump these bottles around. And I thought of these bottles like stray dogs, like people think of stray dogs. So I started to collect them, and then clean them, and then put flowers in them, and then distributed these bottles around on campus in different departments. And they made everything look so nice. So everyone can do that. And everyone can do that. You can look at something which is dumped, and then instead of making it part of the dirt in the environment, you can take it out, make it something beautiful, something creative, and use it. And in this way, we can be able, from small things that we can do as human beings, we can build a better environment, a better society. And that's part of the message that Pope Francis is sending. He's not saying that the government should take care of everything. He's saying that you, as a human being, as one individual, you walk in the street, you find a garbage, somebody has dumped some garbage here, just pick it up and put it in the garbage waste. And so in this way, you have made that part of the street better, look much, much nicer. And this is the significance of what he is saying. To conclude, Laudato Si makes it clear that the goal of the protection, conservation, and development of the vital elements of the environment, namely land, air, water, and soil, is for the universal good for all living creatures and for the preservation and continuation of life. Similarly, all the Holy Scriptures calls upon man to build and maintain a healthy and clean environment which is devoid of any source of pollution and misuse. Here, The paramount lesson of Laudato Si is that humans need to take care of all the elements of nature which God has created for our own welfare and our endurance. Being mindful of the environment and ultimately Mother Earth is the best way to serve God and our community and to reciprocate for God, for what God has entrusted us. We need to join hands to protect our environment and keep our planet Earth tranquil and peaceful. Let us be inspired by the rich themes in the encyclical Laudato Si. Let us start by spreading public awareness together with our civil society and faith organizations by organizing a march to bring public awareness for the themes of climate change, human dignity, and the Earth living creatures raised in the encyclical Laudato Si. Such a march from Jerusalem to Tel Aviv would bring Jews, Christians, Muslims, seculars, Israelis, and Palestinians together who share our common love for the Earth. So here, this is so important that we, as conflicting parties, find areas where we both agree, where we both can benefit, and this is one of them. The environment is one of them. And this will bring us, as Israelis, as Palestinians in conflict, in midst of conflict, to be able to work together in order to improve the environment. In the encyclical Laudato Si, the Holy Father asked the international community an important question. What kind of world do we want to leave for those who come after us, to children who are now growing up? No doubt, we want to leave for those who come after us, to our children who are now growing up, a better world than the one left to us by our parents. Allow me to borrow the same question and ask the Israeli and Palestinian communities the same question. What kind of world do we want to leave for those who come after us, to our children who are now growing up? His Holiness Father Francis ends with the words of hope. Let me walk in his shoes and end with words of hope. Hope that we will leave our children a better world in which conflict would have come to an end, a world in which moderation would erode extremism and love would conquer hate and peace would triumph over war and life would defeat death. I do hope that Laudato Si will inspire us to make the dream of a better tomorrow a reality. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thanks, Professor Mohammed.